Dans un motel, dans un motel, j'avais envie de mourir. Suicide, suicide-moi. Suicide-moi. En plein désert. Motel, motel suicide. J'ai quitté la lumière du jour. Suicide, suicide-moi. Suicide-moi. Ils m'ont bien pris en charge. Tout était prévu. depuis longtemps. Les entraîneuses étaient très belles. Musclées. Affectueuses. Suicide, suicide-moi. La musique. La musique qui prête à mourir. Était plus douce de jour en jour. Suicide, suicide-moi. Un jour, je me suis surpris. À rire. Et je ne voulais plus mourir. Ne me suicide plus. Mais j'avais payé pour ça. Et les gens du motel du motel suicide. Les gens du motel suicide sont honnêtes. Pendant mon sommeil, ils m'ont envoyé selon le contrat.
I found myself.
La mort.
Myself laughing. And I didn't want to die.
La mort climatisée.
But I had paid for that.
Suicide-moi, suicide-moi.
Suicide means suicide.
Avant qu'il soit trop tard pour mourir.
To die, to die. Too late to die.
Trop tard pour mourir. Trop tard pour mourir.
Too late.
Un poème d'opéra de Jean Cocteau, dit par l'auteur, La Toison d'or. L'éternité, place bouclée et cannelée, j'imagine l'antiquité, haute du nez, bouclée du pied, lissée de la tête aux pieds. Place bouclée, l'éternité, place bouclée, l'antiquité, place bouclée et annelée, annelée et cannelée, ailée, boulée, boutonnée, la rose mouillée, bestonnée, boutonnée et déboutonnée, la mer sculptée et contournée, la colonne aux cheveux frisés. De l'éternité.
The dance is an art in space and time. The object of the dancer is to obliterate that. The classical ballet, by maintaining the image of the Renaissance perspective in stage thought, kept a linear form of space. The modern American dance, stemming from German Expressionism, and the personal feelings of the various American pioneers, made space into a series of lumps, or often just static hills on the stage, with actually no relation to the larger space of the stage area, but simply forms that by their connection in time made a shape. Some of the space thought coming from the German dance opened the space out and left a momentary feeling of connection with it, but too often the space was not visible enough because the physical action was all of a lightness, like sky without earth or heaven without hell. The fortunate thing in dancing is that space and time cannot be disconnected, and everyone can see and understand that. A body still is taking up just as much space and time as a body moving. The result is that neither the one nor the other, moving or being still, is more or less important, except it's nice to see a dancer moving. But the moving becomes more clear if the space and time around the moving are one of its opposite, stillness. Aside from the personal skill and clarity of the individual dancer, there are certain things that make clear to a spectator what the dancer is doing. In the ballet, the various steps that lead to the larger movements or poses have, by usage and by their momentum, become common ground upon which the spectator can lead his eyes and his feelings into the resulting action. This also helps define the rhythm, in fact, more often than not does define it. In the modern dance, the tendency or the wish has been to get rid of these unnecessary and balletic movements, at the same time wanting the same result in the size and vigor of the movement as the balletic action, and this has often left the dancer and the spectator slightly short. To quibble with that on the other side, one of the best discoveries the modern dance has made use of is the gravity of the body in weight. That is, as opposite from denying and thus affirming gravity by ascent into the air, the weight of the body in going with gravity down. The word heavy connotes something incorrect, since what is meant is not the heaviness of a bag of cement falling, although we've all been spectators of that too, but the heaviness of a living body falling with full intent of eventual rise. This is not a fetish or a use of heaviness as an accent against a predominantly light quality, but a thing in itself. By its nature, this kind of moving would make the space seem a series of unconnected spots, along with the lack of clear connecting movements in the modern dance. A prevalent feeling among many painters that lets them make a space in which anything can happen is a feeling dancers may have too. Imitating the way nature makes a space and puts lots of things in it, heavy and light, little and big, all unrelated, yet each affecting all the others. About the formal methods of choreography, some due to the conviction that a communication of one order or another is necessary, others to the feeling that mind follows heart, that is, form follows content, some due to the feeling that the musical form is the most logical to follow. The most curious to me is the general feeling in the modern dance that 19th century forms stemming from earlier pre-classical forms are the only formal actions advisable or even possible to take. This seems a flat contradiction of the modern dance, agreeing with the thought of discovering new or allegedly new movement for contemporary reasons, the using of psychology as a tremendous elastic base for content, and wishing to be expressive of the times, although how can one be expressive of anything else, but not feeling the need for a different basis upon which to put this expression, in fact being mainly content to indicate that either the old forms are good enough, or further that the old forms are the only possible forms. These consist mainly of theme and variation and associated devices, repetition, inversion, development, and manipulation. There is also a tendency to imply a crisis to which one goes and then in some way retreats from. Now, I can't see that crisis any longer means a climax, unless we are willing to grant that every breath of wind has a climax, which I am. But then that obliterates climax being a surfeit of such. And since our lives, both by nature by the newspapers, are so full of crisis that one is no longer aware of it, then it is clear that life goes on regardless, and further that each thing can be and is separate from each and every other, viz. The continuity of the newspaper headlines. Climax is for those who are swept by New Year's Eve. More freeing into space than the theme and manipulation holdup would be a formal structure based on time. Now, time can be an awful lot of bother with the ordinary pinch-penny counting that has to go on with it, but if one can think of the structure as a space of time in which anything can happen in any sequence of movement event and any length of stillness can take place, then the counting is an aid towards freedom rather than a discipline towards mechanization. A use of time structure also frees the music into space, making the connection between the dance and the music one of individual autonomy connected at structural points. The result is the dance is free to act as it chooses, as is the music. The music doesn't have to work itself to death to underline the dance, or the dance create havoc in trying to be as flashy as the music. For me, it seems enough that dancing is a spiritual exercise in physical form, and that what is seen is what it is. And I do not believe it is possible to be too simple. What the dancer does is the most realistic of all possible things, and to pretend that a man standing on a hill could be doing everything except just standing is simply divorce. Divorce from life, from the sun coming up and going down, from clouds in front of the sun, from the rain that comes from the clouds and sends you into the drugstore for a cup of coffee, from each thing that succeeds each thing. Dancing is a visible action of life.
So gut. Die Frau, die trägt Ohrringe, der Herr Busfahrer auch. Schwere Gestalter, das Leben ging weiter. Juppidoo, 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 juppidoo. Große Wohnung, nie zu Hause, kleine Wohnung, tiefe Blicke.
Krebs ohne Karies.
Juppidoo, juppidoo, juppidoo. Juppidoo, juppidoo. Quatti lieben Mutti, Nudeln sind für Tutti.
Krebs ohne Karies.
Juppidoo, juppidoo, juppidoo. Juppidoo, juppidoo. Juppidoo.
für Max und Helmut Kohl, dem Fixer. Einmal den Doppelknocker Harris mit Salamander.
Sur le pavé des cours, un ange qui sanglote accroché dans un arbre, la colonne d'azur qu'entortille le marbre font ouvrir dans ma nuit des portes de secours. Un pauvre oiseau qui meurt et le goût de la cendre, le souvenir d'un œil endormi sur le mur. Et ce point douloureux qui menace l'azur font au creux de ma main ton visage descendre. Ce visage plus dur et plus léger qu'un masque est plus lourd à ma main qu'au doigt du receleur le joyau qui l'empoche. Il est noyé de pleurs, il est sombre et féroce, un bouquet vers le casque. Ton visage est sévère, il est d'un pâtre grec. Il reste frémissant au creux de mes mains closes. Ta bouche est d'une morte où tes yeux sont des roses et ton nez d'un archange et peut-être le bec. Le gel étincelant d'une pudeur méchante qui poudrait tes cheveux de clairs astres d'acier, qui couronnait ton front d'épines de rosier. Quel haut mal a fondu si ton visage chante? Dis-moi quel malheur fou fait éclater ton œil d'un désespoir si haut que la douleur farouche, affolée en personne, orne ta ronde bouche, malgré tes pleurs glacés, d'un sourire de deuil. Ne chante pas ce soir les costauds de la lune. Gamin d'or, sois plutôt princesse d'une tour, rêvant mélancolique à notre pauvre amour, ou soit le mousse blond qui veille à la grand'une.
Thank you.
Il descend vers le soir pour chanter sur le pont parmi les matelots à genoux et nu-tête, l'Ave Maria Stella. Chaque marin tient prête sa verge qui bondit dans sa main de fripon. Et c'est pourtant manché, beau mousse d'aventure, qu'ils bandent sous leur froc les matelots musclés. Mon amour, voleras-tu les clés qui m'ouvriront le ciel où tremble la mâture, d'où tu sèmes, royal, les blancs enchantements, ces neiges sur mon page, en ma prison muette, l'épouvante, les morts dans les fleurs de violette, la mort avec ses coques, ses fantômes d'amants. Sur ses pieds de velours passe un garde qui rôde. Repose en mes yeux creux le souvenir de toi. Il se peut qu'on s'évade en passant par le toit. On dit que la Guyane est une terre chaude. Oh, la douceur du bagne impossible et lointain. Oh, le ciel de la belle, oh, la mer et les palmes, les matins transparents, les soirs fous, les nuits calmes, oh, les cheveux tondus et les peaux de satin. Rêvons ensemble, amour, à quelque dur amant grand comme l'univers, mais le corps taché d'ombre, il nous bouclera nus, dans ses auberges sombres, entre ses cuisses d'or, sur son ventre fumant, un mac éblouissant taillé dans un archange, bandant sur les bouquets d'œillets et de jasmin que porteront tremblant tes lumineuses mains sur son auguste flanc que ton baiser dérange. Tristesse dans ma bouche, amertume gonflant, gonflant mon pauvre cœur. Mes amours parfumés, adieu, vont s'en aller. Adieu, couilles aimées. Oh, sur ma voix coupée, adieu, chibre insolent. Gamin, ne chantez pas, posez votre air d'apache. Soyez la jeune fille au pur cou radieux, ou, si tu n'as de peur, l'enfant mélodieux mort en moi bien avant que me tranche la hache. Enfant d'honneur si beau couronné de lilas, penche-toi sur mon lit, laisse ma queue qui monte frapper ta joue dorée, écoute. Il te raconte ton amant, l'assassin, sa geste en mille éclats. Il chante qu'il avait ton corps et ton visage, ton cœur que n'ouvriront jamais les éperons d'un cavalier massif, à voir tes genoux ronds, ton cou frais, ta main douce, ô môme, à voir ton âge, voler, voler ton ciel éclaboussé de sang et faire un seul chef-d'œuvre avec les morts cueillis çà et là dans les prés, les haies, morts éblouis de préparer sa mort, son ciel adolescent. Les matins solennels, le rhum, la cigarette, les ombres du tabac, du bagne et des marins visitent ma cellule où me roulent les m'étreint le spectre d'un tueur à la lourde braguette. Ta chanson qui traverse un monde ténébreux, c'est le cri d'un marlou porté par ta musique. C'est le chant d'un pendu raidi comme une trique. C'est l'appel enchanté d'un voleur hameçonné. Un dormeur de 16 ans appelle des bouées que nul marin ne lance au dormeur affolé. Un enfant reste droit contre le mur collé. Un autre dort debout dans ses jambes nouées. C'est le cri d'un marlou porté par ta musique. J'ai tué pour les yeux bleus d'un bel indifférent qui jamais ne comprit mon amour contenu. Dans sa gondole noire, une amante inconnue, belle comme un navire est morte en m'adorant. Ta chanson qui traverse un monde ténébreux, c'est le cri d'un marlou porté par ta musique. Toi, c'est le chant quand tu seras prêt, en armes pour le crime, masqué de cruauté, casqué de cheveux blonds, sur la cadence folle et brève des violons, égorge une rentière en amour pour ta frime. C'est l'appel enchanté d'un voleur enchanté. Apparaîtra sur terre un chevalier de fer, impassible et cruel, visible malgré l'heure, dans le geste imprécis d'une vieille qui pleure. Ne tremble pas surtout devant son regard clair. Cette apparition vient du ciel, redoutable des crimes de l'amour. Enfant des profondeurs, il naîtra de son corps d'étonnante splendeur, du foutre parfumé de sa queue adorable. C'est le chant d'un pendu raidi comme une trique. C'est l'appel enchanté d'un voleur à mouchoir. Rocher de granit noir sur le tapis de laine, une main sur sa hanche, écoute le marché. Marche vers le soleil de son corps sans péché et t'allonge tranquille au bord de sa fontaine. Chaque fête du sang délègue un beau garçon pour soutenir l'enfant dans sa première épreuve. Apaise ta frayeur et ton angoisse neuve. Suce mon membre dur comme on suce un glaçon. Mordille tendrement le paf qui bat ta joue. Baise ma queue enflée. Enfonce dans ton cou le paquet de ma bite avalée d'un seul coup. Étrangle-toi d'amour. Dégorge et fais ta moue. Adore à deux genoux comme un poteau sacré mon torse tatoué. Adore jusqu'aux larmes mon sexe qui se rompt, te frappe mieux qu'une arme. Adore mon bâton qui va te pénétrer. Il bondit sur tes yeux, il enfile ton âme. Penche un peu la tête et le vois se dresser, l'apercevant si noble et si propre au baiser. Tu t'inclines très bas en lui disant, madame, madame, écoutez-moi, madame, on meurt ici, le manoir est hanté, la prison vole et tremble, au secours, nous bougeons, emportez-nous ensemble, dans votre chambre au ciel, dame de la merci, appelez le soleil, qu'il vienne et me console, étranglez tous ces coqs, endormez le bourreau. Le jour sourit mauvais derrière mon carreau. La prison pour mourir est une fade école. Sur mon cou, sans armure et sans haine, mon cou, que ma main plus légère et grave qu'une veuve effleure sous mon col, sans que ton cœur s'émeuve, laisse tes dents poser leur sourire de loup. Oh, viens, mon beau soleil, oh, viens, ma nuit d'Espagne, arrive dans mes yeux qui seront morts demain, arrive, ouvre ma porte, apporte-moi ta main, Mène-moi loin d'ici, battre notre campagne. Le ciel peut s'éveiller, les étoiles fleurir, ni les fleurs soupirer, et des prés l'herbe noire accueillir la rosée où le matin va boire. La cloche peut sonner, moi seul je vais mourir. Oh viens, mon ciel de rose, ô ma corbeille blonde, visite dans sa nuit ton condamné à mort, arrache-toi la chair, tue, escalade, mort, mais viens, pose ta joue contre ma tête ronde. Nous n'avions pas fini de nous parler d'amour. Nous n'avions pas fini de fumer nos gitanes. On peut se demander pourquoi les cours condamnent un assassin si beau qu'il fait pâlir le jour. Amour, viens sur ma bouche. Amour, ouvre tes portes, traverse les couloirs, descends. Marche léger, vole dans l'escalier, plus souple qu'un berger, plus soutenu par l'air qu'un vol de feuilles mortes. Oh, traverse le mur, s'il le faut, marche au bord des toits, des océans, couvre-toi de lumière, use de la menace, use de la prière, mais viens, ô ma frégate, une heure avant ma mort. Les assassins du mur s'enveloppent d'aurore. Dans ma cellule, ouverte au champ des hauts sapins qui la bercent, accrochée à des cordages fins noués par des marins que le clair matin dort. Qui grava dans le plâtre une rose des vents? Qui songe à ma maison du fond de sa Hongrie? Quel enfant s'est roulé sur ma paille pourrie à l'instant du réveil d'amis se souvenant? Divague ma folie, enfante pour ma joie, inconsolant enfer, peuplé de beaux soldats, nus jusqu'à la ceinture, et des frocs réséda tirent ces lourdes fleurs dont l'odeur me foudroie. Arrache, on ne sait d'où, les gestes les plus fous, dérobe des enfants, invente des tortures, mutile la beauté, travaille les figures et donne la Guyane aux gars pour rendez-vous. Oh mon vieux Marny, oh Cayenne la douce, je vois les corps penchés de 15 à 20 fagots autour du minot blond qui fume les mégots crachés par les gardiens dans les fleurs et la mousse. Un clope mouillé suffit à nous désoler tous. Dressé seul au-dessus des rigides fougères, le plus jeune est posé sur ses hanches légères, immobile, attendant d'être sacré l'époux. Et les vieux assassins se pressant pour le rite, accroupis dans le soir, tirent d'un bâton sec un peu de feu que vole actif le petit mec plus émouvant et pur qu'une émouvante bite. Le bandit le plus dur dans ses muscles polis se courbe de respect devant ce gamin frêle. Monte la lune au ciel, s'apaise une querelle, bouge du drapeau noir les mystérieux plis. T'enveloppe si fin tes gestes de dentelle, une épaule appuyée au palmier rougissant, tu fumes. La fumée en ta gorge descend, tandis que les bagnards, en danse solennelle, grave, silencieux, à tour de rôle, enfant, vont prendre sur ta bouche une goutte embaumée, une goutte, pas deux, de la ronde fumée que leur coule ta langue. Ô frangin triomphant, divinité terrible, invisible et méchante, tu restes impassible, aigu, de clair métal, attentif à toi seul, distributeur fatal enlevé sur le fil de ton hamac qui chante. Ton âme délicate est par-delà les monts, accompagnant encore la fuite ensorcelée d'un évadé du bagne au fond d'une vallée mort, sans penser à toi, d'une balle au poumon. Élève-toi dans l'air de la lune, ô Magos. Viens couler dans ma bouche un peu de sperme lourd qui roule de ta gorge à mes dents, mon amour, pour féconder enfin nos adorables noces. Colle ton corps ravi contre le mien qui meurt d'enculer la plus tendre et douce des fripouilles en soupesant, charmé, tes rondes blondes couilles. Mon vie de marbre noir t'enfile jusqu'au cœur. Oh, vise-le, dressé dans son couchant qui brûle et va me consumer. J'en ai pour peu de temps, si vous l'osez, venez, sortez de vos étangs, vos marais, votre boue où vous faites des bulles. Âme de mes tués, tuez-moi, brûlez-moi, Michel-Ange exténué, j'ai taillé dans la vie. Mais la beauté, Seigneur, toujours je l'ai servi, mon ventre, mes genoux, mes mains roses des mois. Les coqs du poulailler, l'alouette gauloise, les boîtes du laitier, une cloche dans l'air, un pas sur le gravier, mon carreau blanc et clair, c'est le luisant joyeux sur la prison d'ardoise. Messieurs, je n'ai pas peur. Si ma tête roulait dans le son du panier avec ta tête blanche, la mienne par bonheur, sur ta gracile hanchou, pour plus de beauté sur ton cou, mon poulet. Attention, roi tragique à la bouche entrouverte, j'accède à tes jardins de sable désolé, où tu bandes, figé, seul, et deux doigts levés d'un voile de lin bleu, ta tête recouverte. Par un délire idiot, je vois ton double pur, amour, chanson, ma reine. Est-ce un spectre mal entrevu lors des jeux dans ta prunelle pâle qui m'examine ainsi sur le plâtre du mur? Ne sois pas rigoureux, laisse chanter matine à ton cœur bohémien, m'accorde un seul baiser. Mon Dieu! Je vais claquer sans te pouvoir presser dans ma vie une fois sur mon cœur et ma pine. Pardonnez-moi, mon Dieu, parce que j'ai péché. Les larmes de ma voix, ma fièvre, ma souffrance, le mal de m'envoler du beau pays de France, n'est-ce assez, mon Seigneur, pour aller me coucher, trébuchant d'espérance, dans vos bras embaumés, dans vos châteaux de neige? Seigneur des lieux obscurs, je sais encore prier. C'est moi, mon Père, un jour, qui me suis écrié. Gloire au plus haut du ciel, ô Dieu qui me protège, Hermès, aux tendres pieds. Je demande à la mort la paix, les longs sommeils, le chant des séraphins, leurs parfums, leurs guirlandes, les angelots de laine en chaude houppelande, et j'espère des nuits sans lune ni soleil sur d'immobiles landes. Ce n'est pas ce matin que l'on me guillotine. Je peux dormir tranquille. À l'étage au-dessus, mon mignon paresseux, ma perle, mon Jésus, s'éveille. Il va cogner de sa dure bottine à mon crâne tondu. Il paraît qu'à côté vit un épileptique. La prison dort debout au noir d'un champ des morts. Si des marins sur l'eau voient s'avancer les ports, mes dormeurs vont s'enfuir vers une autre Amérique.
Amy Taubin.
I have no idea how people who have grown up without what Andy did, which is to fetishize that incredibly rich celluloid image, that image that you could be enveloped by or enter or something like that, and that the early Warhol silent films look like beautiful nitrate film, in part because he was doing that very minimal high-contrast lighting. I mean, they were ravishingly beautiful. But I think that what most fascinated me was that they were running at silent speed, a third slower than life. It has to do with the notion that the film, its heartbeat isn't in sync with your heartbeat as the viewer, that I found incredibly mysterious because it was both distant and enveloping. You were separate from it because those people up there, they were moving slower than life.
Sometime in 1963, Andy Warhol bought a Bolex film camera, 16mm film camera. It was sort of the classic first filmmaker's camera. It was one of the first cameras that I ever shot a movie with. Mine was a wind-up camera. You had to wind it up and you could shoot for 20 or 30 seconds before you had to stop and then wind it up again. Andy's had an electric motor that allowed you to shoot the entire 100-foot roll of film, which would give you about 3.5 minutes of footage at 24 frames a second, the speed of sound film. Silent films originally played at about 16 frames a second, but they had to increase that speed to 24 when sound came in because they needed the film to be passing over the magnetic recording heads faster than 16 frames a second. So when you got your Bolex, you could change the frame rate. Andy chose to shoot his first film and most of his subsequent silent films at the 24 frames per second rate, the rate for sound film, even though he was shooting them silently. And then his specifications were that the films would be projected at the silent film rate, which was 16 frames a second. This all sounds very complicated, but the effect basically was that all of his first films, his silent films, were really to be shown in slow motion. Slowing down the film rate did slow down the motion in the film, and it gave everything a kind of slightly dreamlike quality that was hard to put your finger on, especially
in things like the screen test where the subject under the camera's eye was not moving very much. But there was still a strange shift in time and biorhythm. And you can see this very clearly in his first film, Sleep. Of course, he wanted to make a long film, but he was shooting with this Bolex, which could only shoot 100-foot rolls at a time. So his solution was to shoot many rolls, and each roll would have a different camera setup. You could use a different lens, a different angle. And this really gives the lie to people who felt that Andy made static films later in his career because he didn't know enough about filmmaking to do anything else, or was intimidated by editing, or didn't have a camera eye, or didn't trust his eye for framing. Because in his first film, he did all of those. There is editing, there is camera movement, there is shifting of angles and so on. In other words, his ultimate decision to pare down the filmmaking to its most basic, just put the camera on a tripod, don't move the camera much, maybe zoom in a little or back, and that's it. That was an aesthetic decision. It didn't come out of technical ignorance or intimidation. On the other hand, it's true that the first films that he made were also a learning process because neither he nor most of his entourage really knew much about lighting or filmmaking in general. They were learning. But as most artists who are good do, Andy made his shortcomings become strengths. He turned his weaknesses into artistic strengths.
I am vastly underappreciated as an artist in my time. I have every confidence that in the future, years after I pass away, I will be in the pantheon of great artists. I will stand tall among artists of note throughout history. But for now, in my time, I must deal with the limitations of the people who I walk this miserable planet with. It is my burden, and I accept it. No truly great artist was ever fully realized in their own time. I expect no difference. But I want you to know that I know I am truly the greatest artist alive on Earth right now. There is no other artist that even compares to how great I am. I submit to you that I am a true artistic genius. No one who makes that claim is considered sane. And I know that as the words left my mouth, the first thought you would have upon receiving them into your ears is that you were in the presence of a true, honest-to-God lunatic. Well, I am not a lunatic. I am brilliant. How often do I have to prove it? Greatness shines from every stroke of my brush. I am not beyond the need for acceptance, for love and respect. While it's true that I occupy great heights, I am lonely. I need you. I need you to like me, to encourage me, so that I can go on creating masterpiece after masterpiece into the future, describing humanity as it is today. There is no one on the planet who can do it as I can. You need me. Wherever I should walk, all I ask is for you to bow your heads. Bow your heads to acknowledge the greatness of a man so in tune with his species that his every action is poetry. Look no further. For the definitive artist of your time, I submit to you that I am that man. And if you acknowledge it, I will rise to even greater heights and create even more splendid artworks. That will humble even the most jaded of you. Trust me. Give me your faith, and I shall deliver you from the wretched, cynical, artless time in which we live. I will restore humanity. When you think of the vastness of space and the smallness of this tiny planet, and you think, how could we be significant? You fall to a knee, and then you look to the heavens, then back to earth, and maybe a small prayer darts through your mind. Heavenly Father, the universe is so large, and I am so small. What can I do to make some kind of difference in the grand scheme of things? God in heaven, bestow upon me the power to create, and perhaps if I take nothingness and work it between my two hands, and create somethingness. That act will elevate my existence above that of ordinary cosmic dust. My hands and my mind and my sadness about the briefness of life will create objects so poignant that my life will have not been lived in vain. And this act is what separates humanity from that of insects, of bacteria. And I am one man, but one man greater than others, because I create. And I create with such love and meaning that what I make speaks of your dilemmas. We all are going to die one day. We all will reach the apex of our lives and then begin to wind down toward death. And in those last days, when you are smarter than you have ever been, have more experience and wisdom, you will think it particularly ironic and bitter that now that you have attained all of this wisdom, that you have to die. And what have you left of yourself on Earth? Perhaps you did a job in which you got paid, but you never really made anything beyond mortgage payments on a house you didn't even build. Well then, as you lay dying, the fear of a meaningless existence hopefully can be eradicated by the knowledge that fellow human beings of yours, namely myself, lived an exemplary life, a life of creativity, a fruitful life, where every day was spent in the pursuit of greatness. You lie on your deathbed, and be at peace, because I, Sean Landers, exist in your world, in your time, and I have great love for you, all of you, and I will see to it that you did not live in vain. I, through my artwork, will embody your struggle for human decency, for knowledge, for righteousness. I will see to it that you, in your brief life, will have meant perhaps something. So help me God. Thank you. ladies and gentlemen, in summation. All I have tried to do in my life is describe the sadness and the beauty of our limitations as we live our lives. We were born with minds of giants, and we live in bodies of ants. This, at first, seems utterly cruel. But upon further reflection, I have come to realize that it is the most beautiful thing that we have. I will make art for the rest of my days. And with every ounce of my being, I will continue to strive for greatness. And because I am so honest in my pursuit of greatness, I will live forever in my art. 2, 3, 4, 500 years from now, my name will be uttered on young lovers of art's lips. Every museum in the world will own artworks of mine. And I am humbled when I think of that. I thank God for the power he has given me, because I am but a man. Please know that I am as real an artist as you have ever met. And that the man you know as Sean Landers is, once and for all, Sean Landers. It's frightening to admit that every word I have said on this tape, I actually believe. But I do. And I love myself for it. I will no longer feel ashamed of who and what I am. I am this man. And I love it. Thank God for me. Leave here now and go outside and ask yourself, do you think God, you are you? Well, I do. I am proud of who I am and what I've become and who I will be centuries after I perish.
Thank you.
dans un motel. Dans un motel. J'avais envie de mourir. Suicide, suicide-moi. Suicide-moi. En plein désert. Motel, motel suicide. J'ai quitté la lumière du jour. Suicide, suicide-moi. Suicide-moi. Ils m'ont bien pris en charge. C'était prévu depuis longtemps. Les entraîneuses étaient très belles. Musclée, affectueuse. Suicide, suicide-moi. La musique. La musique qui prête à mourir. Était plus douce de jour en jour. Suicide, suicide-moi. Un jour, je me suis surpris. rire. Et je ne voulais plus mourir. Ne me suicide plus. Mais j'avais payé pour ça. Et les gens du motel les gens du motel suicide sont honnêtes. Pendant mon sommeil, ils m'ont envoyé selon le contrat.
I found myself.
La mort.
Myself laughing. And I didn't want to die.
La mort climatisée.
But I have paid for that.
Suicide-moi, suicide-moi.
Suicide me and suicide.
Avant qu'il soit trop tard pour mourir.
Too bad, too bad. Too late to die.
Trop tard pour mourir. Trop tard pour mourir.
Un poème d'opéra de Jean Cocteau, dit par l'auteur, La Toison d'or.
Thank you.
quitté, la terre roulée, l'éternité, place bouclée et cannelée, j'imagine l'antiquité, haute du nez, bouclée du pied, lissée de la tête aux pieds. La terre roulée, l'éternité, la te bouclée, l'antiquité, la te bouclée et annelée, annelée et cannelée, elle est moulée, boutonnée, la rose mouillée, bestonnée, boutonnée et déboutonnée, la mer sculptée et contournée, la colonne aux cheveux frisés. De l'éternité.
The dance is an art in space and time. The object of the dancer is to obliterate that. The classical ballet, by maintaining the image of the Renaissance perspective in stage thought, kept a linear form of space. The modern American dance, stemming from German expressionism and the personal feelings of the various American pioneers, made space into a series of lumps, or often just static hills on the stage, with actually no relation to the larger space of the stage area, but simply forms that by their connection in time made a shape. Some of the space thought coming from the German dance opened the space out and left a momentary feeling of connection with it, but too often the space was not visible enough because the physical action was all of a lightness, like sky without earth or heaven without hell. The fortunate thing in dancing is that space and time cannot be disconnected, and everyone can see and understand that. A body still is taking up just as much space and time as a body moving. The result is that neither the one nor the other, moving or being still, is more or less important, except it's nice to see a dancer moving. But the moving becomes more clear if the space and time around the moving are one of its opposite, stillness. Aside from the personal skill and clarity of the individual dancer, there are certain things that make clear to a spectator what the dancer is doing. In the ballet, the various steps that lead to the larger movements or poses have, by usage and by their momentum, become common ground upon which the spectator can lead his eyes and his feelings into the resulting action. This also helps define the rhythm, in fact, more often than not does define it. In the modern dance, the tendency or the wish has been to get rid of these unnecessary and balletic movements, at the same time wanting the same result in the size and vigor of the movement as the balletic action, and this has often left the dancer and the spectator slightly short. To quibble with that on the other side, one of the best discoveries the modern dance has made use of is the gravity of the body in weight. That is, as opposite from denying and thus affirming gravity by ascent into the air, the weight of the body in going with gravity down. The word heavy connotes something incorrect, since what is meant is not the heaviness of a bag of cement falling, although we've all been spectators of that too, but the heaviness of a living body falling with full intent of eventual rise. This is not a fetish or a use of heaviness as an accent against a predominantly light quality, but a thing in itself. By its nature, this kind of moving would make the space seem a series of unconnected spots, along with the lack of clear connecting movements in the modern dance. A prevalent feeling among many painters that lets them make a space in which anything can happen is a feeling dancers may have too. Imitating the way nature makes a space and puts lots of things in it, heavy and light, little and big, all unrelated, yet each affecting all the others. About the formal methods of choreography, some due to the conviction that a communication of one order or another is necessary, others to the feeling that mind follows heart, that is, form follows content, some due to the feeling that the musical form is the most logical to follow. The most curious to me is the general feeling in the modern dance that 19th century forms stemming from earlier pre-classical forms are the only formal actions advisable or even possible to take. This seems a flat contradiction of the modern dance, agreeing with the thought of discovering new or allegedly new movement for contemporary reasons, the using of psychology as a tremendous elastic base for content, and wishing to be expressive of the times, although how can one be expressive of anything else, but not feeling the need for a different basis upon which to put this expression, in fact being mainly content to indicate that either the old forms are good enough, or further that the old forms are the only possible forms. These consist mainly of theme and variation and associated devices, repetition, inversion, development, and manipulation. There is also a tendency to imply a crisis to which one goes and then in some way retreats from. Now, I can't see that crisis any longer means a climax, unless we are willing to grant that every breath of wind has a climax, which I am, but then that obliterates climax being a surfeit of such. And since our lives, both by nature, by the newspapers, are so full of crisis that one is no longer aware of it, then it is clear that life goes on regardless, and further that each thing can be and is separate from each and every other, viz. The continuity of the newspaper headlines. Climax is for those who are swept by New Year's Eve. More freeing into space than the theme and manipulation hold up would be a formal structure based on time. Now, time can be an awful lot of bother with the ordinary pinch-penny counting that has to go on with it, but if one can think of the structure as a space of time in which anything can happen in any sequence of movement event and any length of stillness can take place, then the counting is an aid towards freedom rather than a discipline towards mechanization. A use of time structure also frees the music into space, making the connection between the dance and the music one of individual autonomy connected at structural points. The result is the dance is free to act as it chooses, as is the music. The music doesn't have to work itself to death to underline the dance, or the dance create havoc in trying to be as flashy as the music. For me, it seems enough that dancing is a spiritual exercise in physical form, and that what is seen is what it is. And I do not believe it is possible to be too simple. What the dancer does is the most realistic of all possible things, and to pretend that a man standing on a hill could be doing everything except just standing is simply divorce. Divorce from life, from the sun coming up and going down, from clouds in front of the sun, from the rain that comes from the clouds and sends you into the drugstore for a cup of coffee, from each thing that succeeds each thing. Dancing is a visible action of life.
Yuppie-doo. yuppie-doo-bee-doo, yuppie-doo. Es gibt viele Autos, grandotot. Ich hub für sie, das tut mir so gut. Die Frau, die trägt Ohrringe, der Herr Busfahrer auch. Wäre gescheiter, das Leben ging weiter. Juppidu, 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 juppidu. Große Wohnung, nie zu Hause. Deine Wohnung, tiefe Blicke.
Krebs oder Karies.
Juppidu, juppidu, juppidu. Juppidu, bidu, juppidu. Vati, liebe Mutti, Nudeln sind für Tutti.
Krebs oder Karies.
Juppidu, juppidu, juppidu. Juppidu, bidu, juppidu.
Für Max und Helmut Kohl, dem Fixer. Einmal den Doppelknocker Harris mit Salamander. Imperialismus, Mus, Mus. Loch in der Bahn, Bahn, wo sonst?
Krebs oder Karies.
Juppidu, juppidu, juppidu. Der Schließmuskel nicht mehr funktioniert, Renatal, meinetwegen.
Krebs oder Karies, Krebs oder Karies.
Juppidu, juppidu, juppidu. Du, du.
Sur le pavé des cours, un ange qui sanglote accroché dans un arbre, la colonne d'azur qu'entortille le marbre font ouvrir dans ma nuit des portes de secours, un pauvre oiseau qui meurt et le goût de la cendre, le souvenir d'un œil endormi sur le mur. Et ce point douloureux qui menace l'azur font au creux de ma main ton visage descendre. ce visage plus dur et plus léger qu'un masque et plus lourd à ma main qu'au doigt du receleur, le joyau qui l'empoche. Il est noyé de pleurs, il est sombre et féroce, un bouquet vers le casque. Ton visage est sévère, il est d'un pâtre grec. Il reste frémissant au creux de mes mains closes. Ta bouche est d'une morte où tes yeux sont des roses, et ton nez d'un archange et peut-être le bec. Le gel étincelant d'une pudeur méchante qui poudrait tes cheveux de clairs astres d'acier, qui couronnait ton front d'épines de rosier. Quel haut mal a fondu si ton visage chante? Dis-moi quel malheur fou fait éclater ton œil d'un désespoir si haut que la douleur farouche, affolée en personne, orne ta ronde bouche, malgré tes pleurs glacés, d'un sourire de deuil. Ne chante pas ce soir les costauds de la lune. Gamin d'or, sois plutôt princesse d'une tour, rêvant mélancolique à notre pauvre amour, ou sois le mousse blond qui veille à la grande lune. Il descend vers le soir pour chanter sur le pont parmi les matelots à genoux et nu-tête, l'Ave Maria Stella. Chaque marin tient prête sa verge qui bondit dans sa main de fripon. Et c'est pourtant manché, beau mousse d'aventure, qu'ils bandent sous leur froc les matelots musclés. Mon amour, voleras-tu les clés qui m'ouvriront le ciel où tremble la mâture, d'où tu sèmes, royal, les blancs enchantements, ces neiges sur mon page, en ma prison muette, l'épouvante, les morts dans les fleurs de violette, la mort avec ses coques, ses fantômes d'amants. Sur ses pieds de velours passe un garde qui rôde. Repose en mes yeux creux le souvenir de toi. Il se peut qu'on s'évade en passant par le toit. On dit que la Guyane est une terre chaude. Oh, la douceur du bagne impossible et lointain. Oh, le ciel de la belle. Oh, la mer et les palmes. Les matins transparents. Les soirs fous, les nuits calmes, oh, les cheveux tondus et les peaux de satin. Rêvons ensemble, amour, à quelque dur amant grand comme l'univers, mais le corps taché d'ombre. Il nous bouclera nus dans ses auberges sombres, entre ses cuisses d'or, sur son ventre fumant, un mac éblouissant taillé dans un archange, bandant sur les bouquets d'œillets et de jasmin que porteront tremblant tes lumineuses mains sur son auguste flanc que ton baiser dérange. Tristesse dans ma bouche, amertume gonflant mon pauvre cœur. Mes amours parfumés, adieu, vont s'en aller. Adieu, couilles aimées. Oh, sur ma voix coupée, adieu, chibre insolent. Gamin, ne chantez pas, posez votre air d'apache,
Soyez la jeune fille au pur cou radieux, ou, si tu n'as de peur, l'enfant mélodieux mort en moi bien avant que me tranche la hache. Enfant d'honneur si beau couronné de lilas, penche-toi sur mon lit, laisse ma queue qui monte frapper ta joue dorée, écoute, il te raconte ton amant l'assassin, sa geste en mille éclats. Il chante qu'il avait ton corps et ton visage, ton cœur que n'ouvriront jamais les éperons d'un cavalier massif, à voir tes genoux ronds, ton cou frais, ta main douce, ô môme, à voir ton âge, voler, voler ton ciel éclaboussé de sang et faire un seul chef-d'œuvre avec les morts cueillis çà et là dans les prés, les haies, morts éblouis de préparer sa mort, son ciel adolescent. Les matins solennels, le rhum, la cigarette, les ombres du tabac, du bagne et des marins visitent ma cellule où me roulent et m'étreint le spectre d'un tueur à la lourde braguette. Ta chanson qui traverse un monde ténébreux, c'est le cri d'un marlou porté par ta musique, c'est le chant d'un pendu raidi comme une trique, c'est l'appel enchanté d'un voleur enchanté, un dormeur de 16 ans appelle déboulé que nul marin ne lance au dormeur affolé. Un enfant reste droit contre le mur collé, un autre dort debout dans ses jambes nouées. C'est le cri d'un marlou porté par ta musique. J'ai tué pour les yeux bleus d'un bel indifférent qui jamais ne comprit mon amour contenu. Dans sa gondole noire, une amante inconnue, belle comme un navire est morte en m'adorant. Ta chanson qui traverse un monde ténébreux, c'est le cri d'un marlou porté par ta musique. Toi, c'est le chant quand tu seras prêt en armes pour le crime, masqué de cruauté, casqué de cheveux blonds, sur la cadence folle et brève des violons, égorge une rentière en amour pour ta frime. C'est l'appel enchanté d'un voleur enchanté. Apparaîtra sur terre un chevalier de fer, impassible et cruel, visible malgré l'heure, dans le geste imprécis d'une vieille qui pleure. Ne tremble pas surtout devant son regard clair. Cette apparition vient du ciel, redoutable des crimes de l'amour. Enfant des profondeurs, il naîtra de son corps d'étonnantes splendeurs, du foutre parfumé de sa queue adorable. C'est le chant d'un pendu raidi comme une trique. C'est l'appel enchanté d'un voleur à rocher de granit noir sur le tapis de laine, une main sur sa hanche, écoute le marcher. Marche vers le soleil de son corps sans péché et t'allonge tranquille au bord de sa fontaine. Chaque fête du sang délègue un beau garçon pour soutenir l'enfant dans sa première épreuve. Apaise ta frayeur et ton angoisse neuve. Suce mon membre dur comme on suce un glaçon. Mordille tendrement le paf qui bat ta joue. Baise ma queue enflée. Enfonce dans ton cou le paquet de ma bite avalée d'un seul coup. Étrangle-toi d'amour. Dégorge et fais ta moue. Adore à deux genoux comme un poteau sacré mon torse tatoué. Adore jusqu'aux larmes mon sexe qui se rompt, te frappe mieux qu'une arme. Adore mon bâton qui va te pénétrer. Il bondit sur tes yeux, il enfile ton âme. Penche un peu la tête et le vois se dresser, l'apercevant si noble et si propre au baiser. Tu t'inclines très bas en lui disant « Madame, Madame, écoutez-moi, Madame, on meurt ici, le manoir est hanté, la prison vole et tremble, au secours, nous bougeons, emportez-nous ensemble dans votre chambre au ciel, Dame de la merci, appelez le soleil, qu'il vienne et me console, étranglez tous ces coqs, endormez le bourreau. » Le jour sourit mauvais derrière mon carreau. La prison pour mourir est une fade école. Sur mon cou, sans armure et sans haine, mon cou, que ma main plus légère et grave qu'une veuve effleure sous mon col, sans que ton cœur s'émeuve, laisse tes dents poser leur sourire de loup. Ô viens, mon beau soleil, ô viens, ma nuit d'Espagne, arrive dans mes yeux qui seront morts demain, arrive, ouvre ma porte, apporte-moi ta main. Mène-moi loin d'ici, battre notre campagne. Le ciel peut s'éveiller, les étoiles fleurir, ni les fleurs soupirer, et des prés l'herbe noire accueillir la rosée où le matin va boire. La cloche peut sonner, moi seul, je vais mourir. Ô viens, mon ciel de rose, ô ma corbeille blonde, visite dans sa nuit ton condamné à mort, arrache-toi la chair, tue, escalade, mort, mais viens, pose ta joue contre ma tête ronde. Nous n'avions pas fini de nous parler d'amour. Nous n'avions pas fini de fumer nos gitanes. On peut se demander pourquoi les cours condamnent un assassin si beau qu'il fait pâlir le jour. Amour, viens sur ma bouche. Amour, ouvre tes portes, traverse les couloirs, descends. Marche léger, vole dans l'escalier, plus souple qu'un berger, plus soutenu par l'air qu'un vol de feuilles mortes. Ô, traverse le mur, s'il le faut, marche au bord des toits, des océans, couvre-toi de lumière, use de la menace, use de la prière, mais viens, ô ma frégate, une heure avant ma mort. Les assassins du mur s'enveloppent d'aurore. Dans ma cellule, ouverte au champ des hauts sapins qui la bercent, accrochée à des cordages fins, noués par des marins que le clair matin dort. Qui grava dans le plâtre une rose des vents? Qui songe à ma maison du fond de sa Hongrie? Quel enfant s'est roulé sur ma paille pourrie à l'instant du réveil d'amis se souvenant? Divague ma folie, enfante pour ma joie un consolant enfer, peuplé de beaux soldats nus jusqu'à la ceinture et des frocs réséda tirent ces lourdes fleurs dont l'odeur me foudroie. Arrache, on ne sait d'où, les gestes les plus fous, dérobe des enfants, invente des tortures, mutile la beauté, travaille les figures et donne la Guyane aux gars pour rendez-vous. Saint-Barnie, ô Cayenne la douce. Je vois les corps penchés de 15 à 20 fagots autour du minot blond qui fume les mégots crachés par les gardiens dans les fleurs et la mousse. Un clope mouillé suffit à nous désoler tous. Dressé seul au-dessus des rigides fougères, le plus jeune est posé sur ses hanches légères, immobile, attendant d'être sacré l'époux. Et les vieux assassins se pressant pour le rite, accroupis dans le soir, tirent d'un bâton sec un peu de feu que vole, actif, le petit mec plus émouvant et pur qu'une émouvante bite. Le bandit le plus dur dans ses muscles polis se courbe de respect devant ce gamin frêle. Monte la lune au ciel, s'apaise une querelle, bouge du drapeau noir les mystérieux plis. T'enveloppe si fin tes gestes de dentelle. Une épaule appuyée au palmier rougissant, tu fumes. La fumée en ta gorge descend, tandis que les bagnards, en danse solennelle, grave, silencieux, à tour de rôle, enfant, vont prendre sur ta bouche une goutte embaumée, une goutte, pas deux, de la ronde fumée que leur coule ta langue. Ô frangin triomphant, divinité terrible, invisible et méchante, tu restes impassible, aigu, de clair métal, attentif à toi seul, distributeur fatal enlevé sur le fil de ton hamac qui chante. Ton âme délicate est par-delà les monts, accompagnant encore la fuite ensorcelée d'un évadé du bagne, au fond d'une vallée mort, sans penser à toi, d'une balle au poumon. Élève-toi dans l'air de la lune, ô Magos. Viens couler dans ma bouche un peu de sperme lourd qui roule de ta gorge à mes dents, mon amour, pour féconder enfin nos adorables noces. Colle ton corps ravi contre le mien qui meurt d'enculer la plus tendre et douce des fripouilles en soupesant, charmé, tes rondes blondes couilles. Mon vie de marbre noir t'enfile jusqu'au cœur. Oh, vise-le, dressé dans son couchant qui brûle et va me consumer. J'en ai pour peu de temps, j'en ai si vous l'osez. Venez, sortez de vos étangs, vos marais, votre boue où vous faites des bulles. Âme de mes tués, tuez-moi, brûlez-moi. Michel-Ange exténué, j'ai taillé dans la vie, mais la beauté, Seigneur, toujours je l'ai servi. Mon ventre, mes genoux, mes mains roses des mois. Les coques du poulailler, l'alouette gauloise, les boîtes du laitier, une cloche dans l'air, un pas sur le gravier, mon carreau blanc et clair, c'est le luisant joyeux sur la prison d'ardoise. Messieurs, je n'ai pas peur. Si ma tête roulait dans le son du panier avec ta tête blanche, la mienne par bonheur, sur ta gracile hanche ou pour plus de beauté sur ton cou, mon poulet. Attention, roi tragique à la bouche entrouverte, j'accède à tes jardins de sable désolé, où tu bandes, figé, seul, et deux doigts levés d'un voile de lin bleu, ta tête recouverte. Par un délire idiot, je vois ton double pur, amour, chanson, ma reine. Est-ce un spectre mâle entrevu lors des jeux dans ta prunelle pâle qui m'examine ainsi sur le plâtre du mur? Ne sois pas rigoureux, laisse chanter matine à ton cœur bohémien, m'accorde un seul baiser. Mon Dieu, je vais claquer sans te pouvoir presser dans ma vie une fois sur mon cœur et ma pine. Pardonnez-moi, mon Dieu, parce que j'ai péché. Les larmes de ma voix, ma fièvre, ma souffrance, le mal de m'envoler du beau pays de France, n'est-ce assez, mon Seigneur, pour aller me coucher, trébuchant d'espérance, dans vos bras embaumés, dans vos châteaux de neige. Seigneur des lieux obscurs, je sais encore prier. C'est moi, mon Père, un jour, qui me suis écrié. Gloire au plus haut du ciel, ô Dieu qui me protège, Hermès, aux tendres pieds. Je demande à la mort la paix, les longs sommeils, le chant des séraphins, leurs parfums, leurs guirlandes, les angelots de laine en chaude houppelande, et j'espère des nuits sans lune ni soleil sur d'immobiles landes. Ce n'est pas ce matin que l'on me guillotine. Je peux dormir tranquille. À l'étage au-dessus, mon mignon paresseux, ma perle, mon Jésus, s'éveille. Il va cogner de sa dure bottine à mon crâne tondu. Il paraît qu'à côté vit un épileptique. La prison dort debout au noir d'un champ des morts. Si des marins sur l'eau voient s'avancer les ports, mes dormeurs vont s'enfuir vers une autre Amérique.
Amy Talbin.
I have no idea how people who have grown up without what Andy did, which is to fetishize that incredibly rich celluloid image, that image that you could be enveloped by or enter or something like that, and that the early Warhol silent films look like beautiful nitrate film, in part because he was doing that very minimal high contrast lighting. I mean, they were ravishingly beautiful. But I think that what most fascinated me was that they were running at silent speed, a third slower than life. It has to do with the notion that the film, its heartbeat isn't in sync with your heartbeat as the viewer, that I found incredibly mysterious because it was both distant and enveloping. You were separate from it because those people up there, they were moving slower than life.
Sometime in 1963, Andy Warhol bought a Bolex film camera, 16mm film camera. It was sort of the classic first filmmaker's camera. It was one of the first cameras that I ever shot a movie with. Mine was a wind-up camera. You had to wind it up, and you could shoot for 20 or 30 seconds before you had to stop and then wind it up again. Andy's had an electric motor that allowed you to shoot the entire 100-foot roll of film, which would give you about 3.5 minutes of footage at 24 frames a second, the speed of sound film. Silent films originally played at about 16 frames a second, but they had to increase that speed to 24 when sound came in because they needed the film to be passing over the magnetic recording heads faster than 16 frames a second. So when you got your Bolex, you could change the frame rate. Andy chose to shoot his first film and most of his subsequent silent films at the 24 frames per second rate, the rate for sound film, even though he was shooting them silently. And then his specifications were that the films would be projected at the silent film rate, which was 16 frames a second. This all sounds very complicated, but the effect basically was that all of his first films, his silent films, were really to be shown in slow motion. Slowing down the film rate did slow down the motion in the film, and it gave everything a kind of slightly dreamlike quality that was hard to put your finger on, especially in things like the screen test where the subject under the camera's eye was not moving very much. But there was still a strange shift in time and biorhythm, and you can see this very clearly in his first film, Sleep. Of course, he wanted to make a long film, but he was shooting with this Bolex, which could only shoot 100-foot rolls at a time. So his solution was to shoot many rolls, and each roll would have a different camera setup. You could use a different lens, a different angle. And this really gives the lie to people who felt that Andy made static films later in his career because he didn't know enough about filmmaking to do anything else, or was intimidated by editing, or didn't have a camera eye, or didn't trust his eye for framing. Because in his first film, he did all of those. There is editing, there is camera movement, there is shifting of angles and so on. In other words, his ultimate decision to pare down the filmmaking to its most basic, just put the camera on a tripod, don't move the camera much, maybe zoom in a little or back, and that's it. That was an aesthetic decision. It didn't come out of technical ignorance or intimidation. On the other hand, it's true that the first films that he made were also a learning process because neither he nor most of his entourage really knew much about lighting or filmmaking in general. They were learning. But as most artists who are good do, Andy made his shortcomings become strengths. He turned his weaknesses into artistic strengths.
I am vastly underappreciated as an artist in my time. I have every confidence that in the future, years after I pass away, I will be in the pantheon of great artists. I will stand tall among artists of note throughout history. But for now, in my time, I must deal with the limitations of the people who I walk this miserable planet with. It is my burden, and I accept it. No truly great artist was ever fully realized in their own time. I expect no difference. But I want you to know that I know I am truly the greatest artist alive on Earth right now. There is no other artist that even compares to how great I am. I submit to you that I am a true artistic genius. No one who makes that claim is considered sane. And I know that as the words left my mouth, the first thought you would have upon receiving them into your ears is that you were in the presence of a true, honest-to-God lunatic. Well, I am not a lunatic. I am brilliant. How often do I have to prove it? Greatness shines from every stroke of my brush. I am not beyond the need for acceptance, for love and respect. While it's true that I occupy great heights, I am lonely. I need you. I need you to like me, to encourage me, so that I can go on creating masterpiece after masterpiece into the future, describing humanity as it is today. There is no one on the planet who can do it as I can. You need me. Wherever I should walk, all I ask is for you to bow your heads. Bow your heads to acknowledge the greatness of a man so in tune with his species, that his every action is poetry. Look no further. For the definitive artist of your time, I submit to you that I am that man. And if you acknowledge it, I will rise to even greater heights and create even more splendid artworks. That will humble even the most jaded of you. Trust me. Give me your faith, and I shall deliver you from the wretched, cynical, artless time in which we live. I will restore humanity. When you think of the vastness of space and the smallness of this tiny planet, and you think, how could we be significant? You fall to a knee, and then you look to the heavens, then back to Earth, and maybe a small prayer darts through your mind. Heavenly Father, the universe is so large, and I am so small. What can I do to make some kind of difference in the grand scheme of things? God in heaven, bestow upon me the power to create. And perhaps, if I take nothingness and work it between my two hands and create somethingness, that act will elevate my existence above that of ordinary cosmic dust. My hands and my mind and my sadness about the briefness of life will create objects so poignant that my life will have not been lived in vain. And this act is what separates humanity from that of insects, of bacteria. And I am one man, but one man greater than others, because I create. And I create with such love and meaning that what I make speaks of your dilemmas. We all are going to die one day. We all will reach the apex of our lives and then begin to wind down toward death. And in those last days, when you are smarter than you have ever been, have more experience and wisdom, you will think it particularly ironic and bitter that now that you have attained all of this wisdom, that you have to die. And what have you left of yourself on Earth? Perhaps you did a job in which you got paid, but you never really made anything beyond mortgage payments on a house you didn't even build. Well then, as you lay dying, the fear of a meaningless existence hopefully can be eradicated by the knowledge that fellow human beings of yours, namely myself, lived an exemplary life, a life of creativity, a fruitful life, where every day was spent in the pursuit of greatness. You lie on your deathbed, and be at peace, because I, Sean Landers, exist in your world, in your time, and I have great love for you, all of you, and I will see to it that you did not live in vain. I, through my artwork, will embody your struggle for human decency, for knowledge, for righteousness. I will see to it that you, in your brief life, will have meant perhaps something. So help me God. Ladies and gentlemen, in summation, all I have tried to do in my life is describe the sadness and the beauty of our limitations as we live our lives. We were born with minds of giants, and we live in bodies of ants. This, at first, seems utterly cruel. But, upon further reflection, I have come to realize that it is the most beautiful thing that we have. I will make art for the rest of my days, and with every ounce of my being, I will continue to strive for greatness. And because I am so honest in my pursuit of greatness, I will live forever in my art. 2, 3, 4, 500 years from now, my name will be uttered on young lovers of art's lips. Every museum in the world will own artworks of mine. And I am humbled when I think of that. I thank God for the power he has given me, because I am but a man. Please know that I am as real an artist as you have ever met. that the man you know as Sean Landers is once and for all Sean Landers. It's frightening to admit that every word I have said on this tape, I actually believe. But I do. And I love myself for it. I will no longer feel ashamed of who and what I am. I am this man. And I love it. Thank God for me. Leave here now and go outside and ask yourself, do you think God? You are you? Well, I do. I am proud of who I am and what I've become and who I will be centuries after I perish.